Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Kant, A Very Short Introduction by Roger Scruton. Narrated by Kyle Munley.
Chapter 1. Life, Works, and Character. The greatest modern philosopher was moved by nothing more than by duty. His life, in consequence, was unremarkable. For Kant, the virtuous man is so much the master of his passions as scarcely to be prompted by them, and so far indifferent to power and reputation as to regard their significance as nothing beside that of duty itself. Having confined his life so that he could act without strain according to this ideal, Kant devoted himself to scholarship, entirely governed by congenial routines. The little professor of Königsberg has thus become the type of the modern philosopher, bounded in a nutshell and counting himself king of infinite space. Immanuel Kant was born in Königsberg in 1724, the fourth of the nine children of a poor harness maker. Kant's parents were simple people and devout pietists. At that time, Pietism, a reformist movement within the Lutheran Church, held powerful sway among the lower and middle classes in Germany, consoling hardship with the idea of the sacredness of work, duty, and prayer. Its vision of the sovereignty of conscience was to exert a lasting influence on Kant's moral thinking. Although in some respects anti-intellectual, it was also one of the major forces behind the spread of education in late 17th century Germany, and a pietist school had been established in Königsberg. To this school, Kant, whose talents had been recognized by a wise and benevolent pastor, was sent at the age of 8. It is fortunate for posterity that such an education should have been offered to one of Kant's lowly origins. It was perhaps less fortunate for the young Kant himself, whose gratitude towards his tutors was so mingled with distaste for their oppressive zeal that in later years he forbore all mention of his early schooling. Some impression of its nature can be gathered from a remark in the little treatise on education, edited from Kant's lecture notes late in his life. Many people imagine that the years of their youth are the pleasantest and best of their lives, but it is not really so. They are the most troublesome, for we are then under strict discipline, can seldom choose our friends, and still more seldom have our freedom. In a letter sent to Kant by a former school friend, at a time when both had become famous, the philologist David Röntgen remarked, 30 years have passed since the two of us groaned beneath the pedantically gloomy but not entirely worthless discipline of those fanatics. And it is undeniable that Kant emerged from his schooling with a considerable weight of gloom, together with a remarkable self-discipline. His early manhood was partly devoted to using the second to overcome the first. In this, he was almost completely successful. Despite straitened circumstances, a deformed and diminutive body, and the loss of both a father whom he respected and of a mother whom he deeply loved, Kant soon became one of the most popular citizens of Königsberg, welcomed everywhere for his grace, wit, and ready conversation. Kant entered the university of his native city at the age of 16 and graduated from it 6 years later. Being unable to secure an academic position, he took work as a private tutor in various households. It was not until the age of 31 that he obtained a post at the university, as private docent, an unsalaried employment that conferred the privilege of giving public lectures and the chance of securing a meager reward through private tuition. By then, Kant had already published works on dynamics and mathematics. He had also acquired, through the connections that his position as private tutor made available, the social ease that was to earn him the title of Der Schöne Magister. Königsberg was then a city of some dignity, with 50,000 inhabitants and an important garrison. As a seaport serving the trading interests of Eastern Prussia, it contained a bustling and variegated population, including Dutch, English, Poles, and Russians. The university, founded in 1544 as the Collegium Albertinum, was a cultural center of some importance. Although so much sunk in provincial obscurity by the mid-18th century that Frederick the Great, visiting the city as Crown Prince in 1739, described it as better suited to the training of bears than to becoming a theater of the sciences. Frederick ascended the throne the following year, and did his best to spread into this corner of his kingdom the high culture and intellectual toleration that characterized his reign. Kant, who had already determined to value truth and duty above all things, was therefore fortunate to find that his university offered no major impediments to the pursuit of either. It was perhaps this, as much as his passionate attachment to his birthplace, that prompted him to wait so long for his first appointment, and to continue waiting thereafter for another 15 years before being granted the professorship that he desired. During this period, Kant several times refused offers from other German universities, and continued conscientiously to deliver, in the house where he lodged, the lectures that established his reputation. His intellectual labors were devoted mainly to mathematics and physics, and at the age of 31, he published a treatise on the origin of the universe that contained the first formulation of the nebular hypothesis. His duties required him, however, to lecture on a wide variety of subjects, including physical geography, about which he became, perhaps because of his reluctance to travel, an acknowledged authority. And, in the opinion of one Count Pergstall, who admired the philosopher greatly, a conversational bore. It is to some extent by chance that Kant's professorship was in metaphysics and logic, rather than in mathematics or natural science. From this point in his career, however, Kant devoted his energies entirely to philosophy, rehearsing in his lectures the thoughts that he was to publish 10 years later in works that earned him a reputation as the greatest luminary in Germany. The philosopher J. G. Hamann records that it was necessary to arrive in Kant's lecture room at 6 a.m, 1 hour before the professor was due to appear, in order to obtain a place. And Kant's pupil Jachmann has this to say of the performance: Kant had a peculiarly skillful method of asserting and defining metaphysical concepts, which consisted, to all appearances, in carrying out his inquiries in front of his audience, as though he himself had just begun to consider the question, gradually adding fresh determining concepts, improving bit by bit on previously established explanations, and finally arriving at a definitive conclusion of his treatment of the subject, which he had thoroughly examined from every angle, having given the completely attentive listener not only a knowledge of the subject, but also an object lesson in methodical thought. And in a letter to a friend, the same writer speaks of Kant's lectures on ethics. In these he ceased to be merely a speculative philosopher and became, at the same time, a spirited orator, sweeping the heart and emotions along with him, as well as satisfying the intelligence. Indeed, it was a heavenly delight to hear his sublimely pure ethical doctrine delivered with such powerful philosophic eloquence from the lips of its very creator. How often he moved us to tears, how often he stirred our hearts to their depths, how often he lifted up our minds and emotions from the shackles of self-seeking egoism to the exalted self-awareness of pure free will, to absolute obedience to the laws of reason and to the exalted sense of our duty to others. Jachmann is more fulsome than false, and Kant's fame as a speaker, both in private and in public, earned him wide recognition, long before the publication of his greatest works. Kant's private life is often parodied as one of clockwork routine, fastidious, donnish, and self-centered. It is said, because Heine said it, that the housewives of Königsberg would set their clocks by his time of passing. It is said, because Kant once said it, that his constant concern for his bodily condition displayed a morbid hypochondria. It is also said that the bareness of his house and furnishings displayed an indifference to beauty, and that the punctuality of his routine disguised a cold and even frozen heart. It is true that Kant's life was, if not mechanical, at least highly disciplined. His manservant had instructions to wake him each morning at 5 and to tolerate no malingering. He would work until 7 at his desk, dressed in nightcap and robe, changing back into these garments at once when he had returned from his morning lectures. He remained in his study until 1, when he took his single meal of the day, following it, irrespective of the weather, by a walk. He took this exercise alone, from the eccentric conviction that conversation, since it causes a person to breathe through the mouth, should not take place in the open air. He was averse to noise, twice changing lodging in order to avoid the sound of other people, and once writing indignantly to the director of police, commanding him to prevent the inmates of a nearby prison from consoling themselves with the singing of hymns. His aversion to music other than military marches was indeed notorious, as was his total indifference to the visual arts. He possessed only one engraving, a portrait of Rousseau, given to him by a friend. Kant was aware of the accusations that the intellect draws to itself, and it was to the subject of this engraving that he turned in self-justification, saying that he should have regarded himself as much more worthless than the common laborer had not Rousseau convinced him that the intellect could play its part in restoring the rights of man. Like all people given to the life of the mind, Kant was in need of the discipline that he imposed on himself. Far from crippling his moral nature, his routine enabled him to flower in the ways best suited to his genius. His love of solitude was balanced by an equal love of company. He would invariably have guests at his midday meal, inviting them on the same morning lest they should be embarrassed by the need to refuse some other invitation, and providing for each a pint of claret and, if possible, some favorite dish. He conversed, to the delight and instruction of his companions, until 3, endeavoring to end the meal in laughter. As much, however, from a conviction that laughter promotes digestion as from any natural inclination towards it. Kant's writings contain many flashes of satire, and satire, indeed, was his favorite reading. His indifference to music and painting must be set against his love of poetry. Even his concern for his health was little more than a consequence of the Kantian philosophy of duty. He neither admired nor enjoyed the sedentary life, but regarded it, nevertheless, as indispensable to the exercise of his intellect. Herder, one of the greatest and most passionate writers of the Romantic movement, attended Kant's lectures and afterwards vigorously opposed their influence. He nevertheless thought highly of Kant himself and summarized his character in these words: "I had the good fortune to make the acquaintance of a philosopher who was my teacher. Though in the prime of his life, he still had the joyful high spirits of a young man, which he kept, I believe, into extreme old age. His open brow, built for thought, was the seat of indestructible serenity and gladness. A wealth of ideas issued from his lips, jest and wit and good humor were at his bidding, and his instructional lecture was also the most fascinating entertainment. With the same spirit with which he examined Leibniz, Wolff, Baumgarten, Crusius, and Hume, and analyzed the laws of nature expounded by the physicists Kepler and Newton, he appraised the currently appearing writings of Rousseau, his Emile and his Heloise, as he did every fresh discovery in natural science which came to his notice, estimated their value, and returned, as always, to an unbiased knowledge of nature and of the moral worth of man. The history of mankind, of nations and of nature, natural science, mathematics, and his own experience were the wellsprings which animated his lectures and his everyday life. He was never indifferent to anything worth knowing. No intrigue, no sectional interests, no advantage, no desire for fame ever possessed the slightest power to counteract his extension and illumination of truth. He encouraged and gently compelled people to think for themselves. Despotism was alien to his nature. This man, whom I name with the deepest gratitude and reverence, is Immanuel Kant. I recall his image with pleasure. Kant's duties as a university teacher required him to lecture on all aspects of philosophy, and for many years he devoted the major part of his intellectual efforts to teaching and to publishing short and undeveloped books and papers. His greatest achievement, The Critique of Pure Reason, was also his first major publication, appearing in 1781, when Kant was 57. Of this work he wrote to Moses Mendelssohn, "Although the book is the product of 12 years of reflection, I completed it hastily, in perhaps 4 or 5 months, with the greatest attentiveness to its content, but less care about its style and ease of comprehension." Kant's Philosophical Correspondence, 1759-99, pages 105-106. In an attempt to alleviate the difficulties presented by the critique, he published a short Prolegomena to Any Future Metaphysic Which Shall Lay Claim to Being a Science, 1783, in which brilliant polemic is combined with an obscure condensation of the critique's most offending passages. For the second edition of the critique, in 1787, Kant rewrote the most forbidding sections. Since the result is equally difficult, commentators have come to agree that the opacity of Kant's work stems not so much from the style as from the thought itself. Despite its difficulty, however, the work rapidly became so famous that the critical philosophy was being advocated, taught, opposed, and sometimes even censored and persecuted throughout the German-speaking world. Kant's self-confidence increased, and he was able to write in 1787 to K. L. Reinhold, who did much to popularize Kant's ideas, "I can assure you that the longer I continue in my path, the less worried I become that any contradiction will ever significantly damage my system." Kant's Philosophical Correspondence, 1759-99, page 127. The influence of Kant's first critique is justly summarized by Madame de Stael when, 30 years after the first edition, she wrote that, "When at length the treasures of thought which it contains were discovered, it produced such a sensation in Germany that almost all which has been accomplished since, in literature as well as in philosophy, has flowed from the impulse given by this performance." During the 12 years of reflection to which Kant refers in his letter to Mendelssohn, he published almost nothing, and his earlier pre-critical writings are of peripheral interest to the students of his mature philosophy. However, once the critical philosophy had achieved expression, Kant continued, with increasing confidence, to explore its ramifications. The Critique of Pure Reason dealt in a systematic way with metaphysics and the theory of knowledge. It was followed by the Critique of Practical Reason, 1788, concerned with ethics, and the Critique of Judgment, 1790, concerned largely with aesthetics. Many other works were added to those, and Kant's collected writings in the so-called Berliner Ausgabe now fill 32 volumes. Of these other works, three will particularly concern us. The Prolegomena, already mentioned. The groundwork of the Metaphysic of Morals, which appeared in 1785, before the Second Critique, and contains a compelling expression of Kant's moral theory, and The Metaphysics of Morals, a late work published in 1797, which contains Kant's ideas on politics and law. During the reign of Frederick the Great, Königsberg breathed the air of enlightenment, and Kant enjoyed the esteem of Frederick's ministers, in particular of von Zedlitz, the Minister of Education, to whom the Critique of Pure Reason is dedicated. A marked change occurred when Frederick William II ascended the throne. His minister, Wollner, exerted great influence, and, becoming responsible for religion in 1788, attempted to bring religious toleration to an end. Kant's Religion Within the Limits of Reason Alone was published in 1793 under the imprint of the Königsberg Philosophy Faculty, thus escaping censorship on a point of law. Wollner, mightily displeased, wrote in the king's name to Kant, charging him to give an account of himself. Kant replied with a solemn promise to his sovereign not to engage in public discussion of religion, either through lectures or through writings. Kant regarded himself as absolved from this promise by the monarch's death. Nevertheless, this conflict with authority caused him much pain and bitterness. Kant prided himself on being a loyal subject, despite republican sympathies, which he once expressed in the presence of an Englishman with such vivacity as to call forth a challenge to a duel, and with such eloquence as to overcome both the challenge and the opinions of the man who had offered it. The man in question, Joseph Green, was a merchant in Königsberg and subsequently became Kant's closest friend. Kant enjoyed the company of women, provided they did not pretend to understand the Critique of Pure Reason, and twice contemplated marriage. On each occasion, however, he hesitated long enough to ensure that he remained unwed. One day, his disreputable and drunken manservant appeared at table in a yellow coat. Kant indignantly ordered him to take it off and sell it, promising to make good the financial loss. He then learned with amazement that the servant had been married, was a widower, and was now to marry again, the yellow coat having been purchased for the occasion. Kant was appalled at these revelations, and never again looked on his servant with favor. His attitude to marriage was curiously disenchanted, and although he defended the institution in The Metaphysics of Morals, he also described the married state as an agreement between two people for the reciprocal use of each other's sexual organs. Kant's Philosophical Correspondence, 1759 through 99, page 235. The Metaphysics of Morals, page 277. However, in his early Observations on the Sentiment of the Beautiful and the Sublime, 1764, Kant had written eloquently on the distinction between the sexes. He was radically opposed to the view that men and women partake of a common nature, which alone suffices to determine the character of their relations. Instead, he assigned to women a charm, beauty, and capacity to melt the heart that are foreign to the more sublime, principled, and practical sex to which he belonged. This description of women accords with Kant's description of natural beauty. It was nature, above all, that stirred his emotions, and it was to scenes of natural beauty that his mother had taken him as a child, so as to awaken his feelings towards the things she loved. It is possible to discern in his evocations, both of feminine charm and of natural beauty, the residue of erotic feelings which, had they been more actively expressed, might well have broken the routine to which our intellectual history is so heavily indebted. Kant gave his last official lecture in 1796. By that time, his faculties had begun to decline, and a somber melancholy had replaced his former gaiety. Fichte describes him as seeming to lecture in his sleep, waking with a start to his half-forgotten subject matter. Soon he lost his clarity of mind, his ability to recognize old friends, even his ability to complete simple sentences. He faded into insensibility and passed from his blameless life on the 12th of February, 1804, unaccompanied by his former intellectual powers. He was attended to his grave by people from all over Germany, and by the whole of Königsberg, being acknowledged even in his senility as the greatest glory of that town. His grave crumbled away and was restored in 1881. His remains were moved in 1924 to a solemn neoclassical portico attached to the cathedral. In 1950, unknown vandals broke open the sarcophagus and left it empty. By that time, Königsberg had ceased to be a center of learning, had been absorbed, following its brutal destruction by the Red Army, into the Soviet Union, and had been renamed in honor of one of the few of Stalin's henchmen to die of natural causes. A bronze tablet remains fixed to the wall of the castle overlooking the dead and wasted city, bearing these words from the concluding section of the Critique of Practical Reason. Two things fill the heart with ever-renewed and increasing awe and reverence, the more often and the more steadily we meditate upon them: the starry firmament above and the moral law within. It is fortunate for the inhabitants of Kaliningrad that they are daily reminded of two things that they may still admire. Chapter 2. The Background of Kant's Thought. The Critique of Pure Reason is the most important work of philosophy to have been written in modern times. It is also one of the most difficult. It poses questions so novel and comprehensive that Kant judged it necessary to invent technical terms with which to discuss them. These terms have a strange beauty and compulsion, and it is impossible to acquire a full appreciation of Kant's work without experiencing the order and connectedness that his vocabulary imposes upon the traditional problems of philosophy. Nevertheless, the gist of Kant's thought can be expressed in a lowlier idiom, and in what follows I shall try to eliminate as many of his technicalities as I can. The task is not easy, since there is no accepted interpretation of their meaning. While a picture of the Kantian system is common to all who have commented on it, there is no agreement whatsoever as to the strength or even to the content of his arguments. A commenter who presents clear premises and clear conclusions will invariably be accused of missing Kant's argument, and the only way to escape academic censure is to fall into the verbal mannerisms of the original. It has become, in recent years, slightly easier to risk this censure. Contemporary Kantian studies, in particular in Britain and America, have tended to the view that the obscurity of Kantian scholarship is often a product of its confusion. In order not to attribute the confusion to Kant, scholars have labored hard to elicit from, or at least to impose upon, the first critique and interpretation that renders it intelligible. I shall try to do the same, and shall be more influenced by these contemporary studies than I am able to acknowledge. The first problem posed by the interpretation of the Critique of Pure Reason is this: what are the questions that it hopes to answer? Kant wrote in the preface to the first edition, "In this enquiry I have made completeness my aim, and I venture to assert that there is not a single metaphysical problem which has not been solved, or for the solution of which the key at least has not been supplied." Critique of Pure Reason, First Edition, page Roman numeral 13. While this represents the ambition, if not the achievement, of the first critique, Kant was in fact motivated by more specific interests. If we turn to the historical antecedents of Kant's argument, we can extract from the philosophical controversies that influenced him certain major subjects of dispute. The most important we find to be the problem of objective knowledge, as this had been posed by Descartes. I can know much about myself, and this knowledge often has a character of certainty. In particular, it is senseless, according to Descartes, to doubt that I exist. Here, doubt only confirms what is doubted. Cogito ergo sum. In this case, at least, I have objective knowledge. The fact that I exist is an objective fact. It is a fact about the world and not just about someone's perception. Whatever the world contains, it contains the thinking being who I am. Kant's contemporary Lichtenberg pointed out that Descartes ought not to have drawn this conclusion. The cogito shows that there is a thought, but not that there is an I who thinks it. Kant, similarly dissatisfied with Descartes' argument and with the doctrine of the soul that flowed from it, felt that the certainty of self-knowledge had been wrongly described. It is true that, however skeptical I may be about the world, I cannot extend my skepticism into the subjective sphere, the sphere of consciousness. So I can be immediately certain of my present mental states. But I cannot be immediately certain of what I am, or of whether, indeed, there is an I to whom these states belong. These further propositions must be established by argument, and that argument has yet to be found. What is the character of this immediate and certain knowledge? The distinguishing feature of my present mental states is that they are as they seem to me and seem as they are.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.